What kind of a peace do I mean, and what kind of a peace do we seek? Not a Pax Americana, enforced on the world by American weapons of war. I am talking about genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on Earth worth living, not merely peace in our time, peace in all time.
In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happily ever aftering than here in Camelot.
Sir, as head of this average family, what was this new experience undergone by you and the members of your household?
Well, after 2 years of brushing with the Crest toothpaste, our group had 21% fewer cavities with Crest.
If it's not presumptuous, Mrs. Kennedy, what about your role as a mother and a wife? Can one have a role as First Lady? We haven't had a First Lady who's had young children for such a long time. Are you optimistic about fulfilling this role in the same way you did before?
Yes, I think it doesn't matter what else you do if you don't do that part well, if you fail your husband and your children. That really is the role which means the most to me.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
And these few golden days I'd spend with you. These golden days I'd spend with you.
Good day, Radio Rick Spector here. We're here to commemorate that horrific date of November 22nd, 1963, 60 years ago. And our topic is Philadelphians and the remembrances of the Kennedy assassination. We're here with Joel Spivak, resident of South Philadelphia. He's an architect, an artist, and he does a lot of great things to preserve the history of South Philadelphia. Joel, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
And sure. And our first question, how old were you, Joel, when JFK was assassinated?
I was 24 years old.
And where were you when you heard of the event?
I was at work at an engineering office. The place was called Industrial Engineers. I was a draftsman there.
Where was it located?
Was on Wayne Avenue, Wayne and Mannheim, in the Germantown section. It was an office full of draftsmen, basically.
So what was your reaction? Who told you when you got the news?
Well, the secretary came into the room. She had her own little office in the building. And she said, the president has been shot, because that had just happened. And it was just unbelievable. You know what I mean? Like, I couldn't even imagine the president being shot. That's something I thought, you know, happened 100 years earlier or something.
Yes, Lincoln or McKinley. So thoughts flashed through your mind that day. And looking back,
it's just horrible. Actually, it's like our dream, you know. I mean, the whole world had changed because we had this incredible young president who seemed to be a real person more than any other president. I mean, I only had like three presidents before, because Roosevelt was the president for a good part of my life. And then, you know, Truman and Eisenhower. That October, I turned 21. And that November, I voted for Kennedy. That was my first election. And he was very inspiring, a young man, you know, was a good-looking guy who didn't look like an old fart president. and not only that, his inaugural speech about, the, you know, don't ask what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country, was a great inspiration for me to think about my future, and that's what I was going to do. As I got older, I was going to be doing things for my country, which is why I'm such a community activist. He inspired all of my friends because he had this vision of a better place in the world. And that was the beginning of, I guess you could say, social consciousness for a lot of us. You know what I mean? Bob Dylan actually gets most of the credit, I think, for inspiring us to care about the world and care about each other. And Kennedy had that impact as well. And the kind of like everybody felt, especially myself, it's like our dream was shattered when he was killed. It was like, oh no, you know what I mean? This whole optimistic future that we were living into.
There's so much controversy surrounding the president.
Yeah, and there was all, well, there was the controversy and then there was what they called the similarities. They were comparing him to Abe Lincoln and it was Abe Lincoln's secretary was Kennedy, named Kennedy, and Kennedy's secretary was Abe Lincoln, and one was shot in a theater, and they caught the guy in a warehouse, and Kennedy was shot from a warehouse, and the assassin was caught in the theater.
Do you have some thoughts about who killed Kennedy?
Well, the only thought I actually have is it was not Lee Harvey Oswald.
And why do you say that?
I say that because just the way it all played out that day, that night on TV, they seemed to know a whole lot about this guy. You know what I mean? And this is like long before the internet, long before we had access to everybody's paperwork. You know, that night on TV, there was a school teacher and she said, she was talking about Lee Harvey Oswald was, you know, I taught him, you know, 20 years. Here and he was blah 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 blah, and I thought, how do they know all these things about this guy? I mean, people didn't know things about people like we do now. There was no access to all that information. So how come this guy who was, you know, whatever, a clerk in a book warehouse, that they shot him 2 days later or 3 days later? To me, was the convincing moment that this guy had nothing to do. Because that was it. That was the end of him. He couldn't testify about anything. Somehow, I think the world would have been very different had Kennedy remained president.
Good day. This is Radio Rick Spector. And we are very pleased to be with Larry Smallwood. Larry was born and raised in North Philadelphia. He studied in this area at Lincoln and Temple Universities and at Goddard College in New England. Larry co-founded and chaired the Channel 6 Community Advisory Board and did public service work. Larry's co-festival director of Philafilm, which is a great local film festival. And Larry served with the U.S. Army in the Far East, 1963 through 1965. Larry, how you doing?
Okay, very good, Rick.
Mm-hmm. Larry, how old were you when JFK was assassinated?
I was in my mid-20s, early 20s. I was in the cafeteria of 8th Army Headquarters in Seoul, Korea at the time. And announcement came over the loudspeaker that the commander-in-chief had been assassinated in Dallas, Texas.
And what was your reaction of the people around you?
We were shocked. Everybody was completely shocked. You know, we're on the front line at that time. You know, the DMZ separating North and South Korea was some 50 miles away from where we were at the time. I was with the 1st Cavalry Division, the 3rd Headquarters Company, 3rd Brigade Operations and Intelligence.
What did President Kennedy mean to Larry Smallwood?
Well, you know, he was a young guy. He was attractive as a politician to me because he talked about domestic and global issues, particularly with the military, that seemed to fit the times. I was more attracted to his brother, Bobby, than JFK. JFK, as we learned later in years, had a number of human flaws.
Yes.
But Bobby had a mindset and a mission that he undertook that was in tune with the climate, the political climate in the country at the time.
How do you think the world would be different, Larry, if JFK had lived?
I don't think we would have gone to Vietnam. I think he would have been reelected for a second term. I do not think for one second that he would have allowed the entanglement we found ourselves in Vietnam.
And what are your ideas, Larry, about who killed President Kennedy?
There's no question there was a conspiracy. The question is, who were the conspirators? You don't assassinate the most powerful leader in the world in broad daylight in a public, you know, arena without having a lot of things taking place with a lot of people. Who wanted him dead? Why did they want to kill him? But he had many enemies, politically and socially. He was an attractive guy to a lot of people. And there are any number of reasons why a coterie of folks would not just want him out of the way politically, socially, but who want him removed.
Larry, thanks for being with us.
Okay, thank you, Rick.
Hello there, Rick Spector with Jackie Strauss. How are you, Jackie?
I'm well, thanks, Rick.
How are you? Think back about a long time ago, almost 60 years, 11/22/63. Just by way of background, Jackie's a Philly girl born and bred and raised, and now she's a busy widowed mother and grandmom. She enjoyed having been co-host on CBS Philly Radio's Remember When with Steve Ross and Jim Murray. Jackie's busy. She's on the board of directors of the Broadcast Pioneers of Philly, and she's an instructor at Mainline School Night in Radnor, PA. Jackie's blessed with a natural ear, and she plays piano and sings professionally, taking the Remember When show on the road to senior communities. Jackie, November 22nd, 1963, where were you when you heard the news about President Kennedy? And what were you doing at the time?
Well, my husband Stan and I were married on June 30th, 1963. And 5 months later, in November, on the 22nd, I was home. I was in between jobs. And I was listening to the radio to Ed Harvey on a show called The Talk of Philadelphia on WCAU AM. And all of a sudden he announced that the president had been shot, which of course was horrifying to hear. And the first thing I thought was I've got to call my husband, but I couldn't because there were no cell phones back then. And he worked at a big company and there was no way I could talk to him. And it wasn't until he got home from work and walked in the door that we both kind of collapsed on each other and just sobbed uncontrollably. It was just devastating. Well, you know, you start watching and it was on a Friday that it happened. So that whole weekend was nothing but coverage of it. And just these horrifying pictures that I think anyone who was there at the time has etched in their mind. First, the swearing in of President Johnson on Air Force One, with Jacqueline standing there, her suit still covered with blood. Lee Harvey Oswald was being moved from one part of the prison to the other, and Jack Ruby jumped out and shot him dead. And then the funeral And seeing Jackie in that black veil standing there, and the little children, her Caroline and John, and the little boy standing there saluting as the cortege passed by. But we had lost this wonderful, handsome, charismatic man with his beautiful young family. And we called it Camelot. I can't believe that it was 60 years. It's a lifetime ago. I idolized Jacqueline Kennedy. At the time, my hair was dark. And I kind of looked a little like her. I think it helped to have the name Jackie because, you know, people in school called me Jackie Kennedy. But I just loved her sense of style, her fashion sense. My wedding dress, my wedding gown was like a Jacqueline Kennedy style, just very plain, very sophisticated, but plain. And I had a pillbox hat for my veil in admiration for her, the way she dressed. Wonderful man and his wonderful family, and it was taken from us so soon, and in an instant it was gone.
Thanks, Jackie, for being with us.
My pleasure.
It was the first and only time I saw John F. Kennedy in person. My dad, sister, and I rushed down to Northeast Philly's Castor Avenue to see the candidate's motorcade en route to a television appearance for the 1960 presidential campaign. I distinctly remember Kennedy's off-color complexion, probably caused, as we later found out, by his Addison's disease. This was a frightening time to grow up as Kennedy assumed the presidency. I spoke of my nightmares to my parents. Would the Cuban Missile Crisis end in nuclear holocaust and kill us all? Through brilliant back-channel diplomacy, JFK brought us back from the point of doomsday, and the world breathed a collective sigh of relief. I heard about JFK's murder while boarding the school bus home from Fells Junior High that terrible Friday afternoon of November 22, 1963. 60 years later, my school is fenced in piles of rubble. The vice president was kept under tight wraps by Kennedy. My friends and I struggled to name his successor, Lyndon Baines Johnson. Like most Americans, I initially accepted the Warren Commission's conclusion that there was no assassination conspiracy, meaning that Oswald acted alone to kill the president from a perch above and behind the motorcade. I read Mark Lane's Rush to Judgment in 1967, one of a legion of books that exposed the many holes in the Warren Report, the lies, the errors, the important witnesses uncalled, and the evidence suppressed. I've seen the horror of the Zapruder film countless times. The laws of physics can't be changed. The fatal shot thrust President Kennedy violently backward, showing that at least one killer was positioned in front of the president. Dr. Robert McClelland, who attended to President Kennedy in the Parkland Hospital emergency room on November 22, 1963.
Oh, well, the thing that killed him, the bullet, I think, having, you know, seen the wound, and having then, years later, seeing the Zapruder film of the assassination, confirmed to me that the president was shot from the front, most likely, and maybe by someone from the back. But the bullet that killed him, I think, was fired from the front and hit him in the hairline and then blew out the back of his skull on the right side.
And this is where your thinking differs from the Warren Commission's report.
Yes.
Several things I learned stood out to tear more holes in the official version of the assassination. Among the most disturbing, before Officer J.D. Tippit left home on the morning of November 22 to be later allegedly shot to death by Oswald, Tippit, normally an unemotional man, said to his son Alan, "No matter what happens to me today, I want you to know I love you." What did Tippit know in advance about events that would transpire in Dallas midday. On the morning of the assassination, Oswald's killer, Jack Ruby, asked a government informant to join him later in Dealey Plaza to watch the fireworks. If we are to move on as a free people, we must learn the truth about November 22, 1963. Our government must change only through an orderly democratic process, never through violence and deception. Let's hear about the work of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee. And yes, there is a local connection. Philadelphia attorney Vincent Salandria, relentless crusader for truth about the Kennedy assassination, was very helpful in setting up the committee. He also was an esteemed advisor for our next guest. Good day, Radio Rick Spector. We're here today with Dan Storper, who's founder and president of Putumayo. It's a record label focused on creating thematic music from around the world and introduces people to other cultures. Dan serves as secretary of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee. That's the topic of our interview today. 2015, Dan moved full-time to New Orleans, where he became interested in possible connections between plans to overthrow Fidel Castro and the assassination of President John Kennedy. 2019, Dan became involved with the Truth and Reconciliation Committee. That's a group of really prominent folks who seek the truth and importance of these terrible assassinations of the 60s and their consequences for our world today, which still go on. So Dan, welcome to our podcast. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for inviting me. I should clarify that I started out as secretary of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee, but shortly after I was promoted to co-chair. So I'm now co-chair of the committee. Gotcha.
Dan, exactly what is a committee for truth and reconciliation?
The conversation actually began, and it had been going on for years. David Talbot, who's an incredible journalist, who wrote two very important books about the era and about the assassinations, one called Brothers, about the Kennedy brothers, and another called The Devil's Chessboard about Allen Dulles and the CIA. And we had been talking about the idea of establishing a Truth and Reconciliation Committee, patterned to some extent on the South African one, which is clearly the best known. Finally, in 2019, we established a committee, and it was a very impressive group of people, ranging from a couple of the Robert Kennedy family, the kids of Robert Kennedy, people like Rob Reiner, Martin Sheen, Daniel Ellsberg. What I brought in was Reverend James Lawson, who was a mentor to Martin Luther King. There was a member of Martin Luther King's family, his nephew, and several others. And so gradually, and there are a lot of historians and journalists who also believe in the importance of creating an understanding of what really happened with those assassinations in the 60s, how it changed the course of American life, and how it's essentially led to where we are today with a great deal of mistrust of government and the media.
Why'd you get involved with this? Tell us a little bit about your time in New Orleans.
And one night, about 7 years ago, I was having dinner with a friend, and he told me a story about his Cuban mother's involvement in running guns to overthrow Castro and peripheral connection to the Kennedy assassination. And the context and the circumstances and what he related to me led me to be extremely fascinated about what may really have happened in terms of the Kennedy assassination. It became clear to me, as a person who was, you know, my dad was involved in Democratic politics, so I was always interested in politics. I also invited President Kennedy to my bar mitzvah and got a nice little note back from someone in his office saying, unfortunately, he wouldn't be able to attend because of his busy schedule.
I heard nothing from Lyndon. Go ahead.
And unfortunately, had he responded and said he would attend, he wouldn't have been able to because he was assassinated. So the reality was that, you know, as a kid growing up, I was always curious. You know, we all remember where we were when Kennedy was killed, if we're of that age. And I would tear up every time I'd see images, memorials and other kinds of things, that because I felt like there was something lost that was dramatic. Well, when we started out, you know, part of the idea was to develop a groundswell of support around the country for this effort. We weren't sure exactly what would happen, where it would go. We did a major launch in 2019 with media. We got a great article in the Washington Post. But it became clear that other than that Washington Post article, mainstream media was very resistant and still is very resistant to addressing these stories. And you may call it a cover-up of events of those times, partly as one journalist said to a longtime researcher friend of mine, the truth is too terrible, because in a sense, what's happened is, you know, no one trusted, and still virtually no one trusts the Warren Commission. It was not only, as Bobby Kennedy called it, a shoddy piece of work, but it was fundamentally contradictory. We've created a series of primers that are introductions to the various assassinations. We've published two, one on John Kennedy, one on Bobby Kennedy. If you go to americantruthnow.org, you can find them. We've also listed some very important books, which are great introductions to this realm, one of which is JFK and the Unspeakable by Jim Douglas. The other is Brothers by David Talbot. We've also identified important film introductions, TV, film, documentary. So if you go to the site, you'll see, you can actually watch a very important BBC documentary on the assassination of Martin Luther King, which I'm especially interested in. We've also helped fund and support members of the committee who are doing things like the effort to try and get the final documents released related to the Kennedy assassination. So there's a lawsuit going on by organized by three of our board members to essentially sue the National Archives and President Biden to force the release of the remaining documents. I'm trying to do is support people that are working on films, podcasts, and other types of projects that are raising awareness. I would say at this point, you know, we're planning two or three initiatives that we will announce. And if you sign up at americantruthnow.org, you'll be informed about the work that we're doing. We are always happy to accept donations. One of the goals of those donations is to continue the work. You know, what I'm hoping to do is coordinate a college tour of a couple of speakers. A positive side that the House Committee, Select Committee on Assassinations did in the 70s was point out that there was a conspiracy. I encourage anybody that's interested to sign up at americantruthnow.org and look forward to continued work in this area.
Blue skies smiling at me. Nothing but blue skies. Blue I see.
Bluebirds
singing a song. Nothing but bluebirds all day long. All the days are hurrying by. When you're in love, my heart they fly. Blue days, all of them gone. Nothing but blue skies
overhead
from now on.
Mr. House.